Quest Audiobooks presents an unabridged recording of What Dies Inside Us by Tony J. Forder. Narrated by Andrew Cullum. The Beginning of the End. Bliss looked on in horror as the slender young girl backed up onto the rooftop ledge, her face twisted by a dozen creases of anguish, flushed red from tears as she stared at the man who had once been her saviour.
"I'm sorry," she whispered,
barely loud enough for him to hear above a low rumble of thunder and the hiss of traffic passing by on the wet streets below. Her white nightdress glowed like a shimmering apparition against the background of a roiling granite sky.
"I guess in the end we can't help being who we are."
With that, she stepped off the ledge. Bliss rushed forward with both hands outstretched, his fingers grasping flimsy material slick with rain. He made a pair of tight fists, his grip as powerful as it could be, but the girl's momentum wrenched her from his grasp.
"Molly, no!"
Bliss cried. He looked on in impotent horror as she tumbled through the air, unable to avert his gaze while a cry of icy dread died in his throat. Molly's features transformed into an horrific mask of terror, her lips forming a silent scream without end, not even when her shattered body lay on the ground in an ever-expanding pool of blood. Her eyes remained open, almost as if she continued to gaze upon him, but for the first time since he had known her, they finally looked at peace. Bliss sobbed, slumping forward to his knees as he cried out her name one last time to an uncaring world. He leaned out over the edge with his arms extended as if still attempting to rescue her, reaching further and further until he too surrendered to the inevitable pull of gravity and fate. 1. Jimmy Bliss jolted himself out of the unbearable daydream. No slick roof beneath his feet, no leaden sky above, no shattered bodies oozing precious lifeblood across the pavement. He was in his own living room, Molly sitting by his side, the waif he had prevented from killing herself more than 3 years earlier when she was just 15, a girl he had come to love as if she were his own daughter, the young woman who reciprocated out of more than mere gratitude for his having saved her life. Until the darkness inside his head led his thoughts astray, the pair had been engrossed in watching the Pink Floyd Pulse DVD. Between them on the sofa lay Max, a golden Labrador who finally seemed comfortable in the presence of people, having been rescued from his abusive previous owner. On a wide flat screen, David Gilmour exhorted his Fender guitar to produce yet another melodic phrase that made it sound as if the guitar itself were emotionally exhausted, strings bending almost to snapping point. Molly sat with her mouth hanging open, tongue lolling. Beside her, Max did the same. As the band launched into the final stretch of Sorrow, a discordant ringtone spoiled the moment. Bliss groaned and hung his head, reached for the remote to pause the disc before digging into his trouser pocket for the phone. He flashed Molly an apologetic look.
"Sorry to call you, Jimmy. Detective Constable Gal Ansari said to him when he answered, 'I tried my best not to, but ended up not having a choice. I got lumbered because Bish called in sick.'"
Again? This was the third time in as many weeks that Detective Sergeant Bishop had taken a day off. "I do hope it's nothing trivial."
"I know what you mean, boss. But to be fair to him, he did sound rough. Not that it would have mattered in this case. I am sorry, though."
"It's okay, Gull," Bliss said, entirely used to having his downtime interrupted by the demands of his job. He checked his watch and saw that it had just turned 10:30 p.m. "What have you got for me?"
"An odd one."
"They usually are."
"True. This time we have a homeless man in the interview room who claims to have witnessed a murder at Cuckoo's Hollow Park in Werrington. Says he chased off the attacker and tried resuscitating the victim before realizing it was too late. Our witness has no phone, so he made his way to a local pub, who called us after they heard his story. Only when the response unit arrived on scene, There was no sign of a body, no sign of a struggle, nothing out of the ordinary at all. They quizzed the bloke, suggesting he might be confused due to being a bit inebriated. Apparently he reacted badly to that, got a little aggressive, insisting he saw what he saw. They brought him in, expecting to just stick him in a cell and let him sleep it off, except that he demanded to speak to you.
Bliss frowned.
He asked for me by name.
He did. I went down and had a word to see if I could pacify him and get him to talk, but he wouldn't have any of it. Refuses to speak to anyone other than you, boss.
Did our homeless witness give a name?
He did. Roger Craig.
Bliss ran the name through his memory banks but came up with just the one hit.
I know of a Roger Craig who was a running back for the San Francisco 49ers, but unless our witness is a 6 foot 60-something black bloke from Iowa, I have no idea who he is.
Well, you got the height and skin colour right, Jimmy, but our man is more 40-something and sounds to me like a Brummie.
With a reluctant sigh, Bliss said, Okay. Give me 10 minutes, Gull.
You want me to give Penny a bell?
D.S. Penny Chandler was his regular partner, only she wasn't on call either.
No, don't bother her, he said. I can handle this one on my own. Shouldn't take too long.
When he ended the call, he found both Molly and his dog looking at him with pitiful longing in their eyes. Behind Molly's lay mischief, a deliberate ploy to make him feel bad for leaving her. As for Max, he seemed to be learning bad tricks fast.
We'll pine for you, the girl told him.
Bliss raised his eyebrows as he levered himself up off the cushion.
Course you will. I'm sure your heart will bleed.
It will. I genuinely don't know if I'll survive.
I think you'll manage. Just try not to make a mess on my carpet. If you feel the blood leaking out, go and pass out in the garden.
Molly extended a clenched hand in his direction and slowly unwound the middle finger. He shook his head in faux exasperation.
Remind me why I invited you to stay with me, he asked, patting his pockets in search of his car keys.
Because you had a desperate need to be insulted?
Yeah, like I don't get enough of that from Penn.
Clearly not, and I bet she doesn't give you the finger.
He found his keys on the arm of the recliner, the seat of which also held his thin leather jacket, which he slipped into.
No, Penn prefers the traditional British two-finger salute.
See? Now you have something different to look forward to in your old age.
Yeah, thanks.
You going to be back in time to finish watching Floyd?
Bliss shrugged.
I've no idea. I've seen it plenty of times before, so watch the rest of it if you want to.
And if you go up to bed, make sure to lock the front door first, but don't leave the key in it or I won't be able to get in.
Molly sniggered.
That'd be fun, she said.
So would me waking you up by kicking the bloody thing in. I wouldn't give Max his walk before you turn in, will you please?
Of course.
She drew the dog closer to her, both arms draped around his neck. The animal accepted the embrace without fuss.
Bliss nodded. Sorry about this, Molly. I arranged not to be on call tonight, but we're a man down and this shout sounds personal.
She shook her head and waved a hand. No sweat, Jimbo. Truly. Truth is, I'm knackered after all the travelling today. Plus, we have all weekend to catch up. Well, hopefully, that is.
He nodded. I promise. Whatever this is, I'll sort it tonight and make sure somebody covers me until Monday morning if necessary.
Bliss winked and left the house feeling guilty as he closed the door behind him, though reassured that Molly genuinely understood. He drove to the station with his own words echoing inside his head. How many times had he made similar promises to his late wife and subsequent female friends, always with the best of intentions, but also with one eye firmly on the job in hand? 2. DC Ansari was waiting anxiously for him when he entered the body of Thorpe Wood Police Station from the car park. She regarded him warily, but he gave her a smile instead of the irritated grunt she might have been expecting.
No need for another apology, Gull, Bliss said, raising a hand. If the only way to get this bloke to cooperate was to call me out, then you did the right thing.
Thanks, she said uneasily.
But I also know you don't spend as much time with Molly as you'd like, and I hated having to bother you. How's she doing, by the way?
Terrific. Mind you, I only picked her up from the station a couple of hours ago, so I'll tell you more next week. Right now, what's the situation with this Roger Craig bloke?
Nothing further since we last spoke. Like I told you, he's homeless and has recently been getting his head down over at Cuckoo's Hollow, off Skater's Way. He's ex-forces, and although he's down on his luck, he comes across as confident and composed. He admits to having had a couple of beers, but doesn't seem to be drunk, says he's not taking anything stronger, and I'm inclined to believe him.
Bliss thanked the DC, and said he'd find her again before he left. He used his lanyard card to buzz himself through a security door. The corridor beyond led to the interview rooms. The moment he entered IR1, his olfactory senses were assaulted by a variety of odours, the combination of which caused his nose to twitch. There was no stench of urine or feces, for which he was grateful, but the man was ripe with neglect.
"I'm told you requested me by name, Mr. Craig," Bliss said, studying the man closely. Shaved head, weathered face, full beard and moustache, neither wild nor ragged. Clearly he maintained himself whenever possible.
He wore a thin raincoat over a denim shirt and navy jogging trousers, the clothing soiled and threadbare. A beanie hat lay squashed on the table beneath a pair of black gloves.
"If you're Bliss, then yes."
Craig's voice was deep and, as Ansari had intimated, sounded as if he originated from the Birmingham area.
"I am. Forgive me, but do we know each other?"
The man shook his head, the slick dome picking up a reflection off two recessed ceiling lights.
"So, how come you ask for me by name?"
"I know you by reputation only, Inspector. A few years back, an old mucker of mine was beaten to death in the city centre because he was homeless and vulnerable, and because the lads who did it thought nobody would give a damn. That kind of news doesn't take long to spread between us rough sleepers. I was in the library shortly afterwards, reading about the investigation in the local rag, and thinking that somebody cared after all."
"I remember it well," Bliss said with an empathetic nod. "Adrian Summerby. A tragic end and so unnecessary."
Craig set his jaw and nodded.
"See? You even remembered his name. That sort of thing impresses me.
Article in the Telegraph said you took a personal interest in finding the bastards who did it."
"It was a team effort. A team led by you."
Bliss regarded him shrewdly.
"And because I wanted to see a homeless man's killers behind bars, you thought I'd be more inclined to listen to you."
Craig folded his arms beneath his chest and stretched out his legs.
"That's exactly right. A lot of people, some police officers included, see the likes of me and find it easier to dismiss what I have to say because of the way I look and smell and occasionally behave after a few too many drinks. From what I've read, you're the kind of copper who'd be willing to hear me out. I'm sure the officers who responded would have if there'd actually been a body found where you told them it was, Mr. Craig."
The man's lips twisted and his nostrils flared.
"I don't know what to say about that. But I stand by what I saw."
"Tell me about it," Bliss said, sliding onto a chair at the table. "Take your time."
"Oh, not much to tell. I'd made camp for the night, and I was sitting there minding my own business when I heard something. It was away in the distance and muffled, but it sounded like a struggle of some sort. I was tucked out of the way in amongst the trees. But when the sound came again, I could tell it was somewhere over by the bridge, spanning the narrow end of the lake."
"You could tell all this from where you were?"
Craig leaned forward and gave a broad, reflective smile that contained no humour.
"When you're on the desert basin in Helmand, you learn to listen to the breeze drifting in off the mountainside as it creeps along the edges of the valley. Out there, the difference between hearing what it had to say and not could decide whether you lived or died. There were too many predators crawling around out there for my liking. But by far the worst of them were human. And whereas the creatures were silent in their approach, those scurrying on two legs looking to pop off a shot at you with a sniper's rifle were not always as quiet as they thought they were."
"Must have been tough out there," Bliss said.
It was no idle comment. He had a huge amount of respect for those who served.
"What unit were you in?"
"Two para. And yeah, it was no picnic. You came home wounded?
Nope, did 3 tours in all before deciding enough was enough. Left to take up a job working close protection security with an old mate of mine who'd set up his own business. It was all going smoothly when one day, while on the job, I heard the rattle of firearms and the concussive pounding of explosives. At the same time, I clocked that me and my protectee were surrounded by Taliban fighters swarming in off a hillside with us as their only targets. They weren't there, of course. Not physically. And none of what I saw and heard at that precise moment actually happened.
He paused to tap his temple.
It was all inside here. On a positive note, because we're not allowed to be armed, I never killed anybody who happened to be standing close by. On the downside, not only did I lose my job, I also lost my reputation.
Bliss could only imagine what the man must have gone through.
I'm sorry to hear that, Mr. Craig, and I apologize for using your own words against you, but is there a chance that what you saw earlier tonight never really happened either?
The homeless vet responded with a nod and a tight grin.
I understand why you might think that. Difference is, this time, I wasn't back in Afghanistan inside my head, and it wasn't insurgents that I saw. I came bursting out of the trees on the run, and on the path by the bridge, I spotted a man choking the life out of another man with a length of cord or rope or something along those lines. I shouted out and started heading towards them. The attacker legged it. I ran across the bridge after him, but by then he'd disappeared into the trees. I turned and jogged back to the poor sod lying on the deck, but it was already too late. He wasn't breathing. I checked for a pulse, did a bit of CPR, but he was too far gone.
Nodding, Bliss prompted him to explain further.
Okay, so you found yourself in an awkward situation. What then?
I don't really know why. But I took off my heavy overcoat and covered him with it. As you might imagine, I don't have a mobile. But I knew the closest place to get help was probably the Ploughman pub over by Tesco. I got there as quickly as I could. Told the girl behind the bar what had happened. They gave your lot a bell. The landlord was kind enough to calm me down with a splash of brandy, even though I thought I was handling myself okay. Then your lot turned up, drove me back to the park, and we walked through to the bridge.
But the victim, the body, was no longer there.
Craig shook his head, almost in wonder.
Just like my coat. It was like he'd vanished into thin air while it was still draped over him. The two coppers looked at me as if I was bloody insane. That or just pulling a fast one. But I told them straight, I didn't imagine it. I wasn't screwing around with them and I wasn't looking for a knight in the cells. I saw somebody being murdered. I saw a dead body. I tried to save him, and when I couldn't, I covered him with my coat. In fact, when you find the body, it'll probably have a couple of broken ribs from me being too heavy-handed with the resource attempt.
Can you describe the assailant? Bliss asked.
No, not really. There aren't any lights by the bridge, so it was dark other than the moonlight. Impression I got, 6 feet plus, heavy set, and the way he moved, not a kid.
And the victim?
White, about the same height as his attacker, but younger and wiry. One of those awful chin beards, you know, a scruffy growth right on the point of the chin. There was also something over the bridge of his nose, which might have been a scar. No tattoos that I could see.
Bliss smiled. He'd expected the ex-paratrooper to have good physical recall. Craig also came across as both truthful and sane.
And how was he dressed? A plain sweatshirt, its hood pulled over his head, T-shirt, I think, jeans and trainers. And he wasn't familiar. You said you'd been sleeping in the park over the past few weeks, so is there any chance you'd seen him before?
Craig gave a firm shake of the head.
Not that I can recall.
Okay. So what do you think happened to the body? Bliss asked.
Me? I think the killer clocked me running off in the opposite direction, circled back and probably disposed of the body in the lake.
Narrowing his gaze, Bliss said, I find that unlikely. I mean, it stands to reason that anybody investigating a possible murder that close to a lake is going to search it for the missing body, right?
So why risk returning to the scene only to shift it a few yards into an obvious place? Craig spread his hands. You're the detective, Inspector. I'm just an old self-medicating paratrooper. Could be they dumped it in the lake hoping the water would screw with your forensics, but like I say, you're the detective. The one thing I do know is that a dead body didn't just stand up and walk out of there on its own. Bliss acknowledged this with a nod. That, my friend, is one thing we can agree on, he said. Now, let's go over the whole thing one more time.
3. DC Ansari was sitting in the major crime unit working her way through CCTV footage from an ongoing case when Bliss entered from the second floor corridor. The young constable looked up from her screen and raised her eyebrows.
How'd it go? She asked him. All sorted?
That is a good question.
He chewed on his bottom lip before slumping into a chair opposite and relating the broad strokes of the interview.
So, what do you make of it?
I find myself in four minds, Gull. Tell me what you think. 1, everything happened exactly as he says it did, and the killer returned to claim the body. 2, everything happened exactly as he says it did, only he got it wrong about the assault victim being dead. 3, he had some kind of PTSD episode and imagined the entire event. Or 4, he made the whole thing up for reasons we don't yet know.
Ansari considered the options for a moment before saying, I'm inclined to rule out the first and last. The killer coming back to remove the body after being discovered would be a first for me, and Mr. Craig didn't give me the impression of being a liar looking for his 15 minutes of fame.
Nodding, Bliss said, I'm with you. Neither of them sounds or feels quite right. I'm also not buying the PTSD argument, mainly because everything he described was set here and not in the desert. The killer and the victim he saw were regular people, not Taliban and some local Helmand tribesmen. That leaves me with one solution. But Craig was once a trained soldier. He knew how to check for a pulse, carry out CPR, and genuinely believed the man was dead. So much so that he even took time to drape his own coat over the body before running for help. All of which makes me think my third option can't be right either. He paused to take a deep breath, exhaling slowly. But it may just be more right than wrong, because he's not infallible and he could have made a mistake. What do they call that? Occam's razor? That's the one.
Basically, the simplest solution is usually the right one.
But what does that leave us with?
Okay. Not a great deal clearer, then. So how do we proceed? Or do we? Without a body or the slightest sign of struggle, isn't this something to toss back to uniform?
Not yet, no. Because even if we don't like those options, it could be any of them and we have to make certain allowances.
And once made, we have to act.
It was as if DC Ansari could read his mind.
Indeed. It's a puzzle. But it's one I'd like you to solve. I'm going home, but I'm leaving you with a list of jobs to organise.
Bliss paused, eyeing Ansari keenly.
Where's Alan? Isn't he on late as well this weekend?
He is. The duty inspector needed one of us to attend a burglary, so we tossed a coin and he won.
He gave a sly grin.
You and DC Virgil seem to be getting on rather well lately. I noticed how he worked a change in rotation with Phil so that he'd be partnering up with you.
Ansari regarded him with suspicion.
What are you trying to suggest, Jimmy? You have something you want to ask me?
Bliss shook his head innocently.
Not at all. Just saying what I see and wondering out loud, that's all.
For your information, Alan and Phil swapped rotation at Phil's request. With his wedding coming up soon, the changes worked better for Phil and his fiancée. Alan didn't have a problem and neither did I. Anything else you'd like to know?
It was probably time to back off, but that wasn't Bliss's style. As you're asking, he said, are you and Alan seeing each other?
He's not in my command line, so why does it matter?
The DC replied indignantly.
Chuckling, Bliss said, easy there, Tiger. Who said it mattered? I'm asking not as your boss, but as a friend.
Ansari closed her eyes for a moment, perhaps seeking to calm herself. When she opened them again, she looked chastened.
I'm sorry, Jimmy.
The truth is, we've been out together a few times. I don't know how ready I am for dating him, so it's baby steps at the moment. My family won't be pleased, that's for sure.
Because he's not Muslim, or because he's a copper?
A bit of both, she admitted. They can barely stomach me working for the police, so bringing home another officer who also happens to be a white Christian.
If one of my brothers brought home a white girl, my parents wouldn't like it, but they would at least accept it. I don't see them making the same allowances for me, particularly my father.
I'm sorry to hear that, Gull.
Don't be. My father loves me, but he's unlikely to overlook his faith in favor of me. That's just the way things are. He actually might not be overly troubled by my dating Alan, but a father looks to the future, to a wedding, grandchildren somewhere down the line, and that will be his greatest challenge to overcome.
Bliss nodded.
He patted Ansari's hand.
Trust me when I say I have no intention of adding to the drama, but I won't be the only one to have already noticed. In fact, I'm usually slow on the uptake when it comes to relationships, so I'm probably lagging way behind the others. As far as I'm concerned, you two are professionals, and I trust your work will not be compromised.
Mind you, it's time to think beyond me and how your next DI might react.
Cupping her face in both hands, Ansari said, "Please don't. I can't even begin to think about that right now. It's impossible to imagine someone else sitting in your office. By the way, any word on who that might be?"
"Not yet. They interviewed two candidates but rejected them both.
There are strong rumors about DI Bentley wanting to move over from CID. Please tell me that's not going to happen, boss." Bliss noticed the look of angst on his colleague's face. He knew her fears would be shared by others in the team. Bentley was a good copper and he got results, but his methods and manner were questionable at best. He'd been known to throw colleagues under the bus in the furtherance of his own ambition and was widely disliked because of it. He shook his head.
"Not going to happen, Gull. Not on a full-time basis, at least. Word coming down from further up the chain of command is that his career has plateaued unless he moves to another area. All my recent discussions on the subject have centered on the possibility of persuading either Penn or Bish to step up.
Either of them would be great." She checked her enthusiasm. "Not that we want to lose you, Jimmy, but if we must, then continuity is preferable." He made no immediate reply. DS Ollie Bishop's recent behavior and attitude had started to concern him, something he intended to address in the coming days. Also, Bishop had previously enrolled in the Detective Inspector Promotion Training Framework and had undertaken an acting DI role for a period of time, but had later stepped back out. The powers that be were likely to frown upon that and question his temperament and suitability. And when it came to Penny Chandler, she had no ambitions aimed at promotion. She was too busy living her best life as a DS.
"I agree," he said eventually. "But those two have their own lives to consider. I won't try to influence either of them. So I wouldn't count on it if I were you. But look, you know our senior leadership as well as I do. They won't bring in anyone who might throw a spanner in the works. Anyhow, the clock is ticking. Those jobs I mentioned..."
DC Ansari snapped off a mock salute. The action reminded him of another colleague, long gone and greatly missed.
"Yes, sir. Your word is my command."
He gave a vague smile before continuing, "I think we are obliged to treat this as if something actually did happen out there, Gull. But not to the point where I feel it's necessary to pull everybody in, because we have no real evidence to suggest there's a victim missing and a killer to hunt down."
"Sounds about right to me."
"So, here's what needs to be done. The uniforms who brought in Roger Craig had the presence of mind to bag up the man's overcoat. I want you to get that off to forensics ASAP. Fibers, skin cell transfer, DNA, the whole shebang."
"And Mr. Craig himself?" Ansari asked. Bliss gave the question some thought. Judging by their conversation in the interview room, Roger Craig was not in the midst of some form of delusional breakdown. There was no reason to detain the man any further. It was an awkward situation, but not one that threw any suspicion on the ex-paratrooper.
"Ask him for his prints and a DNA swab," Bliss told Ansari. "He'll provide them without argument, I'm sure. Written statement too, before he goes." In reference to the victim, Let's have an initial uniform search of the surrounding area, including the fringes of the lake. If we get nothing from those sweeps, stick an underwater search team in there.
Are you sure about that, boss? That's a major call, given we have no body.
It is, but the body could be in the water. Mr. Craig suggested the killer might have returned to drag his victim into the lake, although that's not what I'm basing it on. I think that if the victim recovered consciousness, was perhaps disorientated as a result, they might easily have staggered into the water by accident.
The young DC was looking quizzically at him. You really think that's likely, boss?
He grinned. At this stage in my career, I'm not concerned about covering my own arse, but wouldn't we all look like prize pricks if we dismissed this one only to have a floater pop up in front of a bunch of kids feeding the ducks?
Ansari arched her eyebrows. You have a point. Should I bring in Pulsar? The police search advisor team was good, but costly to any investigation due to the manpower, or person power, as he was probably supposed to think of it these days. But in this case, the thought that their victim might have wandered away in a daze was all the nudge he needed.
Yeah, go for it, he said. If we're going to do it, let's do it properly. I'll authorize you liaise, and we'll let the experts do their thing.
Bliss turned to leave, then spun back around.
One more thing. Have a word with the SSAFA. I'm not sure if it's still there, but they used to have an office in London Road at the Army Reserve Centre. Find out if our man was known to them, and if so, what they knew.
Sorry, the SS...
It's the Soldiers, Sailors and Airmen's Families Association, a charity for our servicemen and women. And before you ask, Gull, I just want to know this man better than I do at present. And when you're done with him, sort out a car to take him wherever he wants to go tonight.
He left Thorpe Wood less than 10 minutes later. He instructed DC Ansari to bother him only in the event of a result, before popping back to the interview room to arrange a meeting with Craig by the park bridge on Monday morning to go over the events as the man had experienced them.
I'd just like you to walk me through it as you remember it, he said. I'm free to leave? Craig asked, somewhat bemused. Of course, Bliss nodded. You always were. My DC is coming down in a few minutes to have a chat and take your statement. I'll make sure you get a ride back to the park afterwards to grab your things, and then have them take you wherever you like. We have no choice but to move you on because it's a potential crime scene, but I'm sure you have other places to go. I'd let you stay here, but it's Friday night, so I don't think they can spare you a cell. No problem. I'd rather be outside.
The two men shook hands.
See you Monday morning, Bliss said.
He drove home unsatisfied with the outcome, not quite knowing what to believe or expect of the next few days.
4. Monday morning at 7:30 a.m. found Jimmy Bliss at a desk poring over ongoing caseload files to see if any fresh information had been unearthed over the weekend. No movement on any of them meant he and the team would spend the first briefing discussing outstanding and future actions. Crime was a growth industry in Peterborough, with a dramatic increase in serious and violent crimes over the past decade. Not every investigation got the time it deserved, but there were only a certain number of hours in the day. Swinging budget and staffing cuts were partially responsible, but the societal impact ran far deeper than that. He had approached and entered the building earlier with a curious eye. It had been a long time since he'd taken notice of his surroundings in terms of the police station in which he worked, and perhaps because this was the start of his final week as a card-carrying police officer, he was acutely aware of every creaking, groaning, eyesore inch of it. The austere facade never looked anything less than grim, with its dirty sand bricks and water-stained lintels. The style was typical of buildings thrown up in new towns and developing cities across the country during the 70s. Lacking in architectural flair, imagination, and without the finances to strive for better. The interior had seen some cosmetic improvements and modifications while ignoring the more fundamental need for improved plumbing, heating, air conditioning, and electrics. But what Bliss saw when driving in was an exterior that probably hadn't so much as been cleaned since the final brick was first laid.
The offices and open-plan working areas, such as the one he sat in, were functional and no more. New carpeting and decorations improved the look and feel, and the once almost overpowering fog of smoke was, of course, long gone. The biggest change had come about with the introduction of new technology, with monitors on most desks, the computers themselves hidden away. It was a dour and bland building. But then Bliss believed the inspiration had always come from the people who worked within. Over the next 10 or 15 minutes, the room gradually began to fill up around him. In between slurps of black tea from the flask he'd brought from home, he called out a greeting to each member of the major crime team as they came within earshot. He was especially pleased to see that D.S. Bishop had recovered well enough to come in, though the big man appeared to be more than usually dishevelled and not altogether present. When Detective Sergeant Penny Chandler breezed through the doors, she immediately sought him out. "Morning, Jimmy," she said brightly, shedding her jacket and perching herself on the edge of a nearby desk. "How'd it go with Molly this weekend?" The young woman he'd spent the weekend with had been no more than a child at her lowest possible ebb when she entered their lives. Bliss had prevented her from jumping from a hotel roof, and in the days that followed, the kid who had already lived the lives of 10 people touched their own in an indelible way. Having subsequently been relocated, fostered, and later adopted by the same family, Molly had grasped her second chance at a decent future with both hands. Her particular affection for the man who both stopped her from taking her own life and encouraged her to settle into a new one had endured. The two often talked on the phone. He had made several trips down to Torquay, where she lived with her new family, while Molly had also visited him on a couple of occasions after the city had once again been deemed safe for her to return to. Nobody questioned the disparity in their ages or their fondness for one another, for nobody regarded his role in her life as anything other than either paternal or avuncular. Bliss smiled at the more recent memory. "It went very well, thanks, but far too quickly for either of us, so she decided to stick around a while longer. She already prefers to spend time with Max than she does with me, so it works out well for both of them, my being at work today." Chandler laughed and dismissed his observation with a flap of a hand. "That is not true, and you know it. That girl adores you, Jimmy. None of us can understand why, not unless she has a thing for grumpy old buggers, but even a dog as lovely as Max isn't going to take your place in Molly's affections." "Well, either way, she's welcome for as long as she wants to be here. She might as well stay until your retirement due this Saturday." The reminder caught him unawares, hitting him like a punch to the midriff. With the way his shift rota had been scheduled, and allowing for annual leave days he was owed, he knew all too well this was his last full week as a detective inspector. Even so, he was startled anew every time the dying embers of his career as a police officer were stoked. He swallowed down some tea to buy time and cover the abrupt shift in his mood.
"Good idea," he said. "No reason why she shouldn't.
I'm sure it'll be nice to have her around." He tilted a hand one way and then the other.
"We'll see. She shows me about as much respect as you do."
Chandler sucked air between her teeth. "Ooh, that bad, eh?"
Bliss nodded dolefully. "I sometimes wonder why I bother with either of you."
She chuckled. "Simples. Because you love us. Anyhow, I heard you had a shout on Friday night. Anything we need to talk about?" He gave her a thumbs up and briefly outlined the details.
"We may need to spend some time with it today," he told her. "There was no further movement over the weekend, which means Pulsar did not find a body, nor any evidence to suggest there ever was one. I'm not sure if that's a good or bad thing under the circumstances."
"Gull said the witness asked for you by name. Did you know him?"
"No. He knew of me from the Adrian Summerby case a few years back. Seemed to think that meant I had some kind of sympathetic ear for the homeless."
"And do you? I mean, what was the deal there?"
Bliss shrugged. "I genuinely don't know, Pen. You remember the case?"
"How could I not? He got beaten and kicked to death by a bunch of scumbags. As I recall, Bish was even more fired up about it at the time than you were.
I think that's because he was also ex-forces. Serving in some capacity runs in Bish's blood, so it doesn't take much to stir him when a veteran is involved. Me, I reckon it's a crying shame that we don't take better care of them, and nobody deserves to end their days the way Summerby did.
The fact that you called in Pulsar tells me you believe this, Mr. Craig.
Reclining in the office chair, Bliss said,
"Yeah, as it happens, I did.
I'm meeting him at around 10 by the bridge over at the lake, which is approximately where he says the murder took place. He's going to walk me through it stage by stage.
I genuinely don't know if we have a case yet, and I could see nothing in the weekend reports to suggest we have a relevant misper on our hands.
I'm hoping something more will come to him today. Whether that's recalling the incident in greater detail or realising it never happened, I suppose we'll see."
"I can understand why you gave it the necessary time, but to be honest, his story looks pretty weak in the cold light of another day."
Rising to his feet, Bliss gave a reluctant nod.
"It feels that way, Pen.
I'm currently unconvinced, but still curious. Let's get morning prayers out of the way, and then we'll go over it one more time."
Bliss was 10 minutes into the briefing when DCI Diane Warburton entered the room.
"Sorry to interrupt, but this can't wait," she said. "Jimmy, we need to speak to you upstairs in the conference room. Hand off to Bishop Penny, please."
Before he could react, she was gone again, the door thumping closed behind her. Bewildered by the brusque interruption, he wound down the set of actions he'd been discussing before passing the baton to D.S. Bishop. He'd been surprised by his boss's absence from the meeting and couldn't help but wonder what had been so important. He walked to the end of the corridor and took the stairs up to the third floor past Detective Superintendent Marion Fletcher's empty office, only to find her in the conference room with Warburton and the recently promoted Detective Superintendent Alicia Edwards seated either side of her.
"Morning, Jimmy," Fletcher said. "Park your bum and make yourself comfortable for a few minutes."
Bliss took a seat opposite. The DSI's voice was warm but reserved.
"So, no bollocking, but not good news either."
"What's up?" he asked apprehensively.
Fletcher's face turned serious.
"On Friday night, you were called in by DC Ansari at the request of a man by the name of Roger Craig, is that correct?"
"It is. He claimed to have witnessed a murder in Warrington."
"Indeed he did. But no body, no victim at all was discovered, yet you requested a Pulsar team, so you must have given credence to his claim."
He wondered what was going on, concerned by the line Fletcher was taking.
"Not entirely," he admitted, "but neither could I dismiss it out of hand."
In the silence that followed, he felt a twist of anxiety. He met his DSI's focused gaze.
"Marion, what's going on here? What is this meeting about, and why does it involve me?"
"It involves all of us because the immediate issue is one of accountability. At the end of the month, I move up to replace DCS Feely, while at the same time, Alicia here gets her feet under my desk. There's also the question of whether you want to tackle a murder op this close to retirement."
Shifting uncomfortably in his seat, Bliss looked down his nose at the question even being put to him.
"You really have to ask? Of course I want it."
Fletcher nodded, linking her hands together on the table.
"I suspected as much. Jimmy, am I correct in saying you had no prior connection to this Roger Craig?" she asked.
"That's right, yes. He asked to speak with me because he'd read about an old case of ours in a newspaper article."
"What was your impression of him?"
Bliss took a beat or two to answer that one. He thought back to their meeting, Craig's deeply intelligent eyes and earnest voice.
"An honourable man brought to his knees by a system that let him down. From what he told me, he returned from service with PTSD, but because it failed to manifest itself immediately, he never received the support or treatment he needed. He lost everything and wound up sleeping rough. Though less rough than others, I suspect, given he'd spent time in the desert and all that brings."
"So, not the kind of man to tell tall tales, to report a murder he had not actually witnessed?"
"Well, not deliberately, no. Not with any malice, at least. But he wasn't well, and although not drunk, he'd clearly had a couple of beers. Add to that the lack of a victim and him admitting to me that he'd had prior incidents where he'd hallucinated, it was a tough one to call. Look, I'm sorry for being so blunt, but what the bloody hell is going on?"
Are you going to tell me there was a victim after all, that we somehow missed a dead body on Friday night?
Superintendent Fletcher cleared her throat. Jimmy, I'm sorry to tell you this, but earlier this morning the body of a man fitting the description of Roger Craig was found by a couple taking a walk through Cuckoo's Hollow Park. He'd been murdered.
Bliss felt an icy chill whisper over his exposed skin. Suddenly all he could hear was the high-pitched screech of tinnitus raging in both ears. Bile rose up into his throat and he swallowed it back down with a grimace.
How? He asked.
We don't have all the details, but the first officers on scene reported blood loss resulting from a possible stabbing.
Please tell me it didn't happen while we had a police presence in the park.
I can't guarantee it at this stage, not without the post-mortem results and time of death. It's not likely, though. Cuckoo's Hollow is not a large park, and neither is the lake. Both searches were over before sundown on Saturday evening. We couldn't justify keeping officers at the scene or people out of the park when we were unable to confirm a crime had taken place. We therefore believe the murder took place sometime yesterday.
Bliss rubbed the scar on his forehead. Craig had been moved on from his spot on Friday night. Why had he returned 2 days later?
You said he fit the description. Who described him?
The woman who made the call mentioned the victim looked homeless. They also mentioned his skin colour. The car that caught the shout picked up a local PCSO on the way to attend. The community officer knew Mr. Craig reasonably well.
Bliss ran both hands across his face, exhaling over steepled fingers. His mind was racing, yet his thoughts were clear.
This is no coincidence, he said dejectedly. Roger Craig did witness a murder, did attempt to prevent it, and did chase off the attacker. But that same attacker not only returned to remove the body, they also came back for our homeless veteran. The killer knew he'd been seen, and therefore could potentially be described. Whoever it was covered their tracks by murdering our only witness. And I let him go back out there to die.
5. Bliss was quieter than usual during the drive to Werrington. He silently questioned if he could have done more to prevent Roger Craig from being murdered, while his head told him he couldn't have anticipated what would become of the homeless veteran. His heart refused to give up on the notion. Logically, it was hard to think of anything he might have overlooked, said, or done, yet the nagging doubts persisted. He wondered if his determination to spend more time with Molly had distracted him. As they arrived at the scene and spotted onlookers standing outside their front doors or gathered together on the pavement in small, animated pods, Bliss huffed angrily. "Look at them," he sneered. "There's a fairly broad line between curiosity and morbidness, and this lot are on the wrong side of it." Chandler gave him a sidelong glance.
"The only difference between this and any other crime scene we've attended is your mood," she said. "Gawk has got a gawk, Jimmy. Same way they do at the twisted wreckage following a road traffic collision. It doesn't usually bother you."
He accepted her point with a shrug. "Yeah, you're right. I just can't help feeling that our victim didn't have to die. He came to us, came to me, and I sent him away."
"Bollocks. You heard him out. You couldn't have known he was in any danger. Enough with the self-pity, Jimmy. Let's do what we do and find the bastard who murdered him."
Bliss parked alongside a line of liveried traffic vehicles. It was an unseasonably warm late April day, the increasing moisture-laden heat prompting him to loosen the knot of his tie and undo the top button of his shirt the moment they exited the car. He took a deep breath before looking at his partner.
"Sometimes I hate this bloody job," he said.
Chandler peered at him over the rim of her sunglasses.
"And yet we don't seem to be able to get rid of you."
"Like you could cope without me."
A uniformed officer made a note of their presence at the scene before allowing them to pass beneath an entrance cordoned off by taut ribbons of fluttering tape. Bliss didn't know the park well, but had been told to expect a heavily policed area due to the number of entrances into Cuckoo's Hollow.
The pair were directed off the pathway into the trees towards a small gathering of white-suited crime scene investigators. The area CSI manager was on holiday, so today his deputy, Lydia Keane, was in charge. As they approached the tent erected over the body, she handed each of them a bag of protective clothing.
"Good morning, Lydia," Bliss said cheerfully. "How's your luck?"
The woman rolled her eyes. "You tell me," she replied. "Over the weekend, I finally got a date with the pleasant young barista chap from the coffee place I go to every day. 10 minutes into our date, I discover he's neither overly pleasant nor a man."
"What?"
That was my reaction too. Evidently, he happens to be a she. And I mean, she still has all the bits I do. So when she drops this into our conversation, I go into panic mode. "Not so long ago, you could just tell someone there'd been a mistake, that you didn't swing that way. There's me almost having a fit over whether it's somehow offensive to reject a person these days just because they're not the sex you happen to favour. And just at the point where I told myself I was being silly, she proved me wrong."
Wait, Chandler said. "Are you telling me this woman threw a wobbly over you rejecting her because she wasn't a man?"
"Just about. She turned quite nasty because, even though she looks like a man, dresses like a man, walks and talks like a man, but is actually a woman, I'm supposed to ignore all that and date her anyway."
Unable to help himself any longer, Bliss started to laugh. "I'm sorry, Lydia. Only you could get yourself into a scrape like that."
Keane scowled at first, but then saw the funny side. "I ended up feeling dreadful about it. I told her I was sorry, but I was into men, so couldn't go ahead seeing her because she was a woman. And that was the thing, she was still a woman, actually identified as a woman, only she chose to present herself as a man. So go on then, you tell me how my luck is."
Bliss pulled his best sympathetic face. "On the whole, not great," he admitted.
She grunted at him. "I tell you, Jimmy, it's a minefield out there in the dating world."
"He's too decrepit to care about that sort of thing anymore," Chandler remarked. Ignoring his partner, Bliss started climbing into the white suit. He nodded at the clipboard Keane held in one hand. "How far along are you?" he asked.
"We're getting there. The victim has some shocking wounds. I'd say cleaver or machete over carving knife or similar."
Bliss winced at the thought of the man he'd spoken to on Friday night suffering such a brutal attack.
"Any defensive injuries?"
Shaking her head, Keane said, "Nothing obvious in respect of the bladed weapon. You might have to wait for the pathologist, but whatever we find will be in my report."
"In that case, I'm betting he was grabbed from behind. Mr. Craig was an ex-para and still had his wits about him. I don't see him being caught by a frontal attack."
"I'd say you were spot on, Jimmy, though there are signs of a separate attempt. The skin around his throat was scuffed, possibly by some kind of cord. I found similar markings on the palms of both hands and on his fingers, as if he had grabbed at it to wrench it free. Again, the post-mortem will tell you more, but I think he might have shrugged off an initial attack, which resulted in his killer resorting to using the blade."
The first thing Bliss noticed as they entered the tent was Craig's face. One thing he had learned over the years was that death had an impact on expressions, with violent passing resulting in the widest variety. New recruits expected masks of pain, terror, or horror forever etched into the creases and folds of flesh. But the truth was, most appearances were mere empty shells.
Life extinct was often how the dead were pronounced, and he thought it best summed them up. In Craig's case, the man looked almost resigned, as if he had somehow accepted his fate. As if he had perhaps welcomed it. But not like this, Bliss thought. Although the worst of the wounds were hidden beneath the folds and creases of slashed clothing, a gaping maw had been opened up across the face from just below the nose, reaching almost to the top of the ear.
"Surprisingly, not likely to be the one that killed him," Lydia Keane said, following his gaze. "There's a deep laceration along the inside of his right arm. I suspect the brachial artery was severed and he bled out from that. The pathologist will confirm, of course, but that's my take."
He wondered if the cut had been accidental or deliberate. The latter would suggest a more skilled assailant. Despite his lack of nourishment and natural muscle wastage from living on the streets, Craig would not have surrendered easily.
How many wounds in total?
Chandler asked the crime scene deputy manager.
I've not examined the body in detail as yet, but so far I've counted four, all deep and long, applied with some force.
So, a man?
Keane nodded. I'd say so. A strong woman with a very sharp weapon might be capable, but, again, you'll know more after the PM.
Having found his gaze wandering back over Roger Craig's face, Bliss couldn't help but recall their conversation on Friday night. The way he had described having to listen to the breeze in order to stay alive was chilling, and it was hard to believe that same man had been taken by surprise, at least not by somebody who lacked the necessary training. But then he reminded himself that words were cheap, and time could be the fiercest of adversaries people ever had to encounter. In an active war zone, men like Craig were mentally and physically attuned to their surroundings. During moments when a single lack of concentration might cost you your life, it was only natural for instinctive defense mechanisms to function at their peak.
Back here in the real world, weakened by circumstances, perhaps enshrined in a false sense of security or possibly even apathy, Craig had become vulnerable.
I know it's the pathologist's job, he said to Keane, but any idea on time of death? She gave him a knowing smile.
Unlike my boss, I'm willing to be flexible. I can be, you know, given the right circumstances. The body was in full rigor when I arrived, so I'd say our victim has been dead for at least 8 hours.
Bliss thanked Keane, and after discarding the protective garments, headed out of the trees back onto the path towards the bridge. Chandler hurried after him. There were two wooden bridges traversing the lake, one at each end. Their homeless veteran had described the longer of the two as the spot where he had seen the attack taking place and had subsequently administered CPR to the victim. There might be nothing to see, but Bliss wanted not to see it for himself. The bridge provided little of interest. Slightly convex and basic in structure, about 2 dozen paces in length, it was functional and no more. Swans and ducks lingered in the still water below, perhaps anticipating food. Bliss turned to face the trees. If Craig had been in roughly the same place when he heard the scuffle as he was when he was murdered, he would have appeared in the open about 50 or 60 yards away from the two men. Illuminated only by the moon, it was entirely understandable that he had not been able to identify the attacker.
What are you thinking?
Chandler asked him.
Bliss looked up. I'm asking myself what was so important about the victim Roger Craig tried to save.
Important?
Well, not only did the killer make sure to remove the body, but they also came back to silence our homeless vet. I'd say that means the first victim was significant in some way. To whoever murdered him, at least. Nodding, Chandler said,
Whoever that victim was, somebody has to be missing him by now,
you'd think. But no relevant whispers have been reported.
Maybe he wasn't local.
This time it was Bliss's turn to nod.
You could be right. We have to extend our inquiries. I want to know who he was, why he was here, and why somebody wanted him dead.
If they wanted him dead.
What do you mean? He asked.
Chandler surveyed the scene and shrugged.
We still don't have a body, remember? I'm not saying things didn't go exactly as you described, Jimmy. But let's not get ahead of ourselves.
6.
As the pair trudged back into the heart of Thorpewood Station, a female uniform urgently waved a hand at them as she spoke into the phone.
She jabbed the mute button and said, We have somebody waiting to talk to you two. A woman reporting her husband missing.
Sounds positive, Bliss said. Or negative, depending on your point of view, I suppose. Where is she?
I put her in the public interview room myself 10 minutes ago.
We were given notice of the situation at Cuckoo's Hollow Park during the morning briefing and told to keep our ears open for a misper fitting the description. I think this could be our man's wife, Inspector.
Name?
Sharon McKenzie.
Bliss thanked the officer before he and Chandler walked over to a separate room attached to the reception area and stepped inside. The woman waiting for them on a two-seater sofa looked up in alarm. She was thin and frail and mousy, lank hair tied up in a large bun that covered her scalp. She wore sizable hooped earrings, a short denim jacket over a pale yellow dress, and was bare-legged, her feet tucked inside flat-heeled canvas shoes. As Chandler closed the door behind her, Mrs. McKenzie's left hand shot to her mouth, at which point she began nibbling on chipped fingernails. Bliss and Chandler introduced themselves before taking a seat on either side of the sofa. He flashed a warm smile and said,
"Mrs. McKenzie, I believe you're here today to report your husband missing."
Yes, that's right. My husband, Stuart."
Her accent suggested she was locally born and bred.
"I'm sorry to hear that," Bliss said gently. "When was the last time you saw or spoke to him?"
"Friday, just after lunch. He said he had a bit of business to take care of. That was it."
"No phone calls or text messages since?"
She shook her head vigorously. "No, nothing at all."
"I assume you've tried to contact him?"
"Of course. I called his mobile, left voicemails, sent texts and WhatsApp messages. I contacted his parents, his sister and brother, and the friends I know. None of them have seen him or heard from him since he walked out of the house."
Bliss leaned forward. "Was he angry or distressed when he left? Had you two been fighting at the time?"
"No. We hardly ever quarrel."
"In which case, you must be extremely worried."
"Of course I am. I'm frantic with worry."
"Understandably so. Might I ask then, Mrs. McKenzie, why you left it almost 3 days before reporting your husband missing?"
Waving aside the question, the woman said, "Because 3 days is his limit. Look, let me explain. Stu has often gone out and not come home again for a couple of nights, but not to come back by now or call me is unlike him. So I phoned around and the people he usually hangs about with hadn't even heard from him, let alone seen him. And that's when I started to worry. I've never known him go off on his own before." Bliss wondered what kind of relationship these two people had when one of them could be away from home for days without saying why beforehand.
As unlikely as it seemed to him, perhaps it worked well for the couple.
He regarded McKenzie closely as he considered the next step.
"Did you leave a description with the officer who took your details?" he asked.
"Yes, I did. But she told me you'd want me to go over it again,
if you would please."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.